So Josh, how you feel about SpaceCon 2024?
Very toasty, but I know inside I'm gonna be very relaxed and very excited to meet mutuals, maybe a celebrity, just indirectly look at them or something. And yeah, that's pretty much it.
LGBT resellers, so like theory stuff is
really
LGBT, Crimson Dawn is LGBT, and it looks like another sailor right here. pretty much. Even this is LGBT, so.
Talk wherever you want to.
Yeah, I'm just yapping, bro. Still.
Yeah, those LEDs, yeah, they're
I'm talking about the lightsaber thing that he had. There's the Count Dooku one, that usually goes like $400, and it's probably got like the pixels or whatever in it too, so that, and then he has the Aniflex one too, so like, man, it's loud over there.
Yeah. Ooh, that's nice. Ooh.
But yeah, it's
just, this one's pretty dope.
Yeah, that's the one Ezra uses when he's a Padawan. The saber turns off and it shoots a blast, like a stun blast out of it. And this is the one from Ahsoka that he uses. And then, because he doesn't really have any of the kid-friendly ones, so just, all of this is just the high-quality ones here. I think that's just a weathered version of it.
Yeah! What up? What's happening? How you doing, brother? Good to see you.
Yeah,
what's going on? Again?
I had to get out of
the car. Dude, it's so hot, bro. Yeah. I'm surprised you lasted as long as you did.
Even walking out there, absolutely better in terms of the temperature outside, even though it's probably hotter. And then coming back, of all things, because I was thinking of just going to one of those like autographs for like I'm a dance and everything. You just thought I'd just be outside chilling on the phone. Just, hey, how you doing? You know, just glad to see you out here. And always like enjoy your work, and I always love talking about it. So like, yeah, this is one of those little short, quick ones. So I'm like that's what memories bring out. Maybe not.
I'll say even then, walk up to the lines and remember you.
Yeah.
Those moments that they quick interactions.
Yeah.
Thank you. What up?
Okay, Han. 3, 2, 1. Keep that pose. Han. Do horizontal. Yeah, I'm gonna do both ways. Han. 3, 2, 1. All right.
Oh, that's like a
platinum thing.
It's a solid build, bro.
Yeah, it's just right there. That
it's a
there.
Solid build. So the same with my Kanan. So I took the box off of Kanan. Didn't paint it or not, so it's not green. Put the box off the Kanan, bro.
Yeah, there it is. Yeah. Oh man,
that feel good?
Yeah, it does.
Hey, look at that Suba. Look at the scratches.
Oh yeah, heavy contact, bro.
The company that's trying to get the lightsaber to the Olympics.
He's our U.S. representative.
POV shot.
It's very light and everything. It's not built like this. It's not gonna. Okay. Yeah.
Not quite as hard.
That'd be like,
you go a little bit. You go light with it, but you can't do too much.
Like, let's say first person view.
First person.
Okay.
Up, buddy. Up.
Yeah.
Good droid. Yeah, we see you. Oh no, I touched him wrong. Oh no. He's about to short circuit.
Let's go.
Alright. CR2.
Started filming, like Filoni already had you pegged for Ahsoka. Like he already knew, and that's what I love about Filoni is like he had this whole trajectory planned out. And he knew Ahsoka was coming to the fold, and like you were already at the top of the list. Maybe you're the only list. Like how does it feel to kind of already be kind of set up for all that stuff?
It's wild. I mean, you know, he had wanted to make her live action for a really long time, and then they started working on Mandalorian, and he knew he wanted to potentially bring her in, what her, you know, her age and where she'd be at in the storyline. But they wanted to do that first season first, and he was kind of just getting into that space of doing live action, which he had done before. And, you know, Boss Logic had put that piece out, and so, you know, it kind of been stirring for a couple years in the online space, and the fans kind of kicking in and kicking it about. So as they were working on it, it was sort of just like in the back of his mind. So when he actually first called me with John, there had been all of these drawings he had already made of me as Ahsoka that were just like on the walls and all around. As he was like, hey, so we're just wondering if you'd be interested. And it was like, let me think about that. Like, oh wait, I have been thinking about it for years. Actually, that's so funny. Yeah, I'm so excited about this possibility. And I keep looking at, like, you know, your phone gives you these images of, you know, this time several years ago. And I was going through security, and this guy at security was saying, you know, oh my God, I love Ahsoka so much. And I was like, oh, look at the photo that just popped up. And it was me in a costume that was what was gonna be the Ahsoka gray costume, but it still wasn't fully gray. It was just all these different colors and materials, and it was kind of the shape of what it would turn into. And me and Dave and John and the guys, like, it was like really good BTS that I'd never be able to post online, but he got to get a look at just because it popped up on my phone. And it was like, the look and grin on my face, I just can't believe I didn't cost myself the job with the exuberance that I kept showing every day. Like, I literally was doing jumping jacks, and I was like, they're gonna fire me. I'm way too excited.
A lot of time had passed when you got a call and they say, hey, we're thinking about doing this thing, Ewan's on board, we want to bring you back. Is it surreal? Is any part of you nervous? Can I do this again? Were you hesitant at all, or were you just like, I'm ready, let's do this?
Yeah, no, there was zero hesitation. I was elated to get the phone call. You know, I was aware about the Obi-Wan project and that Ewan was coming back to Star Wars, and I was so happy for him, and I wondered if there was maybe going to be an opportunity for me to come in and join him. But yeah, it was a great phone call to get, and, you know, to get to come back and do more with a character that I love so much and that has had such a massive impact on my life was just a real privilege. I mean, what was really exciting for me was that I felt like, you know, Anakin's story had been told in the prequels, and so we sort of had already done all that heavy lifting, and so now it was kind of an opportunity to color the character with a little bit more nuance, and I was such a fan of Dave's storytelling already, and so to sort of get to be a part of his take on the character was something that I just saw as a really awesome opportunity, and I was so pleased with you know, the script. The first time I read the script for Shadow Warrior, I was just blown away. I thought it was really, really exciting, and just thrilled to get to be a part of your show and to get to work with you and play these characters together. It was an awesome opportunity. But as far as like the headspace goes, it's a good question, but it's a tough one to answer too. Just because so much of it is just about sort of gut feeling and intuition, and so I sort of just kind of feel my way through, you know, how that's going to sort of manifest itself and how I'm going to inhabit the character again.
Absolutely. And for you, Ahsoka had been through so much, and it was great seeing like the Clone Wars, the final season. You guys watch that? It kind of showed the potential of how like epic and how much drama you can put to like an animated project. And so your Ahsoka, she's going through all this trauma. She's been through all these dark days in her past. Does any of that did you have conversations with Filoni about like how to bring that to the screen and how to kind of set up her demeanor in this new project and like how you would go forward with her character?
Yeah, I think we had a lot of discussions around her stoicism sort of at that time in her life, and how she's chosen to be a loner. And, you know, she's had a lot of, you know, things that she's that have weighed on her for a long time and kind of kept in the back of her mind. And you'd have these like little instances, you know, when she comes across Grogu and the opportunity to train him, and it, her hesitancy, you know, because of what she sees in him, but also what she fears in herself. And, you know, it was something so delicately kind of played with in those initial moments with her, because it was, you know, when I signed on to do her, it was just for that one episode, you know? It was just a trial.
I had no idea what it was for.
Yeah, it could go, and it could go further, it could not. Like, it literally was just, you know, this is The Mandalorian. I was doing an episode on that show, you know? And then we got to come back around with Boba and, but, you know, it wasn't like when I first signed up that it was this guarantee I was gonna have my own show or do any of, other, of those things. And I think it was, you know, a trial for all of us to just see, you know, and also for the audience to really see if they wanted to continue this story with her. I was so excited that Ahsoka lived and that she got to have a new adventure and that I got to put on this outfit that wasn't just a cosplay experience, but was a new look and a new journey for her.
Yeah, I loved that film. I loved making that film. You know, it was sort of a different take on a superhero story, which I enjoyed. And we traveled all around the world to all the locations that you see in that film. But what was most significant for me personally is that I met the mother of my daughter, and so it actually gave me greatest gift that I've ever gotten, my beautiful daughter, who's actually here today with my mom. Hey, kiddo. So yeah, it was a great film for me, and will always hold a very special place in my heart.
As I mentioned earlier, Ahsoka was absolutely perfection from start to finish. It gave us the drama, it gave us the satisfying story arcs, it gave us all these big epic moments, and you guys were absolutely incredible. Seeing the two of you together was magical, and knowing that you two have come all the way from that tiny little acting school in New York City to, you know, that big stage and fighting in the galaxy, we'll never forget it. Thank you so much for everything you guys do, and thank you for being here.
Anything to your liking, well, sir?
That lightsaber's
yeah.
It's right there.
It is.
I mean, Obi-Wan. Oh, there's just a few.
The other right there? Oh, yeah.
I'm not really a big fan of the Acolyte ones, but this kind of flaky.
Yeah, like, I was surprised how, no, like, because this is a very nice and simple design, and I like it too. It's just right. And I even like this, but I was surprised how hefty that was.
Right.
I appreciate that.
Did they get the whip wings?
Oh, yeah. For our crimson Neo King board that we have, it's just like a lot easier to use than most of the other stuff, so it's a lower price point as well, which helps us out a lot.
Ooh, nice.
And
they would go around and play around. I'd be like, ah!
He's dead.
Right? That's cool. Like, it's good B&B right there. So. Have you seen anything creative based on your own lines, like having the high ground and hello there?
Yeah, when we made the first film, there weren't memes, you know? There weren't, I don't know, I'm trying to remember if there were even cell phones at that point. And it was, to be honest, it was embarrassing. It didn't look very tough or Jedi-like, really. And that morning, somebody said, Robert De Niro's coming in today. We were like, what? Like, Robert De Niro was coming to visit the set. I don't know, as a kid, I don't know why. Maybe he knew it was George, I don't know. But we'd heard this rumor, so we're standing on these things. And it's quite hard to reach each other anyway, because and there's two guys lying. And I'm turning, Hayden said, did you hear that Robert De Niro's coming in today? As I went this way, I saw him sitting with George at the monitor, Robert De Niro. And I came around like this and I went, it's too late, he's here. He's here. That was so embarrassing. And I met him
that's years later. I met Robert De Niro at something he was directing, and I went to speak to him about it. And I told him that story. I was like, so embarrassing. You can't imagine, like, standing in front of one of your heroes and being turned around on a disc. It was so embarrassing. And he was like, nah, what? Anyway, that's one of my highlight moments with him.
Such a wonderful town, San Antonio. Woo! I've been here in a long time. It's really great to be back.
And we were just talking backstage. He was lucky enough to try some good old Texas barbecue.
Oh my gosh. It's probably the best brisket I've ever had in San Antonio. I know people from Memphis are upset at me when I say that. It's true.
They ain't got nothing on Texas.
Just saying.
There's been some, over the last few years, some momentous events that you were just so lucky to be part of and we were so lucky enough to witness. Mm-hmm. So, let's go ahead and start at the top.
Okay.
Keller and Beck. Fans were wondering, since we were introduced to Grogu, aka Baby Yoda, I don't care what you say, I'm still gonna call him that, where on Coruscant did he come from? Talk to us about that first conversation with Favreau and Filoni. How did they present this idea to you that you were going to save Grogu?
Yeah, I mean, it was kind of floating around that Grogu got saved by someone.
Right.
And nobody really knew who it was or who it was going to be. And so even I was, you know, because I love the Mandoverse, but I was just like, where did this kid come from? Like, what was his backstory? And I really loved the fact that they start Grogu's journey like at 50 years old, right? So he has this whole wonderful backstory that they were slowly revealing. And then I get a call on my phone and I was like, Dave Filoni, do I owe him money or something? Like, why is he calling me? And so he was like, we want you to come in and, you know, John and I want to talk to you. And I went to their office and, you know, we had lunch and we were talking. And they were like, well, do you want to come back and be in the Mandalorian? And I was like, I don't know. I really don't know.
And they didn't specify in what way at that time.
Yes, they told me I was going to save Grogu. But they didn't tell me, like, how, right?
You weren't automatically like, Jar Jar Binks might save Grogu?
It was up in the air. Like, for me. For them, they knew. But for me, I was just like, how do they want me to come back, right? And Star Wars takes up your life, you know? Like, there's just so much you have to think about now when you're doing Star Wars, especially since, you know, back in the Phantom Menace days, it was just George, you know? And so everything just began and ended with George. If George thought it was a good idea, we did it, you know? If he didn't think it was a good idea, we didn't do it. But now with Disney, there's a lot of people that you have to talk to. And Dave and John really kind of made it feel like home, you know, because they're both in their own rights, wonderful filmmakers and great storytellers. And it kind of felt like being back in the prequels. And, you know, when I gave them my trepidations about coming back, you know, they were both like, we're going to make sure that you're safe. We're gonna make sure that you're protected. And then I was like, yeah, okay, we'll do it. And then we really collaborated on how this thing was going to happen. They were wonderful. Yeah, Dave, John, Rick Famuyiwa as well. I mean, the three of them were just such an integral part in how this was happening. And they were so very open with me because they knew I was a director, they knew I was a filmmaker, and they were just like, and a writer, and they were just like, well, what do you think? And so we kind of collaborated on the whole thing.
What an awesome team right there.
Yeah, it was pretty great. I just really loved them. And then I get to set, and I put the robes on, and I was like, ah, it's about time.
And, we felt that way too, right?
So how you feel about SaberCon 2024?
Mostly good. I enjoyed the experience. Really hated the beginning of yesterday, but I got blisters for it. But ultimately, I say it was a success.
All right. So yeah, I really enjoyed SaberCon this year. Like my first con, for a fan event. My actual first time. So yeah, I really had a great blast, and I can't wait. Hopefully for the next one.